Pledge allegiance.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today is Gateway Board of School Directors reorganizational meeting, Tuesday, December 6th, 2016. It is 7:37. I apologize, we went a little late in executive session for personnel issues. If we could all please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Can we do a roll call? We'll do a roll call first, please, Bonnie.
Mrs. Byrne?
Present.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Here.
Mr. Lapsovich?
Here.
Mr. Nola?
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Here.
Mr. Ritter?
Here.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Here.
Mrs. Warning?
Here.
Mr. Williams?
Here.
Very good. We'll move into election of a temporary president.
I'd like to make a motion to elect Mr. Steubenbort as a temporary president.
Okay, a motion has been made.
Second.
Any other? Do we have a motion to close?
So moved.
So moved.
Okay, all in favor, just say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, we'll move on to the election of the president. That would be the yellow ballot. Do we have any additional nominations for president? Seeing none.
Neil Nola.
There's a nomination for Neil Nola. Neil, do you accept?
Sure, certainly.
Okay, so if we could all write his name on the top there then. Any other nominations? Okay, seeing none, please put a check mark next to your name on the left-hand side and then put a check mark for whichever individual you'd like to cast your ballot for.
First one, Mr. O'Donnell voted for Mr. Williams. Mrs. Byrne voted for Mr. Williams. Mr. Lapsovich voted for Mr. Williams. Mrs. Warning voted for Mr. Williams. Mr. Steubenbort voted for Mr. Nola. Mr. Nola voted for Mr. Nola. Mrs. Cerucci voted for Mr. Nola. Mr. Ritter voted for Mr. Ritter. And Mr. Williams voted for Mr. Williams.
Very good. Mr. Williams is your new president.
Would it be inappropriate to ask for a recount at this point? No.
I could yes, make a political joke. Cut out a whole bunch of
yourself.
Oh, now you want
money.
Now we need a motion for vice president. Likewise, there's a ballot in front of you.
marking that you would like. Is there a nomination from the floor? Hearing none. Indicated on the ballot.
That's the purple one, right?
Purple. Yeah.
Recount.
Yeah, I'm thinking of, no. I'm thinking I don't want to do it if you're not getting the president.
Thank you, Bonnie.
One more.
This is for Vice President. We have Mr. O'Donnell voted for Mrs. Warning. Mrs. Byrne voted for Mrs. Warning. Mrs. Warning voted for Mrs. Warning. Mr. Steubenbort voted for Mrs. Cerucci. Mr. Nola voted for Mrs. Cerucci. Mr. Ritter voted for Mrs. Cerucci. Mr. Lapsovich voted for Mrs. Warning. Mrs. Cerucci voted for Mrs. Cerucci, and Mr. Williams voted for Mrs. Warning. It's Mrs. Warning. She has five.
Number six, scheduled meetings for 2017. Resolved that the Gateway Board School Director sets calendar of school board meetings for 2017 as attached and authorized the Secretary to advertise said meetings in accordance with the Sunshine Law.
So moved.
Second. Moved and second. Questions, comments?
Please note, Mr. Williams, the Wednesday, November 8th date does not follow the path that we had originally set up for Tuesdays due to Election Day.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Motion passed. Appointment of a solicitor. Resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors appoints Bruce Dyson Associates, PC, as its solicitor, general counsel, and Weiss, Burkhart, and Kramer, LLC, on an as-needed basis for special education services as directed by General Counsel for the period of December 31st, 2016 through December 31st, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Questions, comments? Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Well, Bruce, you know the consequences,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
We're adjourned.
I was going to hear you. Could have voted against. Could have voted against that.
I will call to order.
One second.
The combined study session regular board meeting Tuesday, December 6, 2016, Gateway Board of School Directors. We have a roll call vote, please.
One moment, please. Mrs. Byrne.
Present.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Here.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Here.
Mr. Nola.
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Here.
Mr. Ritter.
Here.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Here.
Mrs. Warning.
Here.
Mr. Williams.
Here. We have no student representative?
No.
Keystone exams, high school.
We need a motion to approve the minutes of the previous meeting.
So moved. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Section B, Mr. Schott.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. Due to early scheduling, typically for December, there is no Section B. Specifically, the Section B list of bills will be addressed in Section F.
Section C. Do we have anything in Section C? Section D, Ms. Crump.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. Resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors accepts and approves the personnel agenda items 1 through 5 as listed in Section D for the regular board meeting of Tuesday, December 6, 2016. Under number 1, we have three resignations listed. Number 2, for transfers, we have 5 transfer per the collective bargaining agreements. Under number 3, for leaves of absences, you will find 14 requests for leaves of absences. 4, for employment, we have 2 substitute teachers listed, 2 substitute food service, a substitute teacher aide, supplemental contracts, resignations, and issuance. And then under section 5, for volunteers, we have 6 volunteers listed.
So moved.
Second.
Comments or questions?
I have a question. On the resignations of the autistic support and special ed, do you have enough to fill those positions? We are currently filling some through MOUs. We will be posting. We have them posted on the website, and we are in the process of interviewing also. Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Daniel.
Question about the number of leaves of absences, is that it seems like a lot, actually.
It does seem like a lot, but it's also because you're going into the second semester, so people have to get in their requests prior to that. Some of them are for intermittent leaves, which means they're not really going to be used unless it's an emergency, so they put it in just to cover themselves. They may never use it, but okay, they put it in there just in case.
So, but we're good, like, you're comfortable?
We have all the documentation, if anything with medical, we have all the medical backup for all of it.
No, but I'm saying you're comfortable with filling if all the people aren't here, actually.
We're working on that. We do have 1 or 2 that we're looking at that we will have to get substitutes in for, but unfortunately, especially with medical, when they have the documentation, we really can't not approve
them. Well, no, yeah.
Isn't there another vacancy coming up for phys ed at Ramsey? I don't see that on here.
It was last month.
Oh,
okay. Mm-hmm. Next month, we will have the substitutes listed that we'll be recommending for long-term subs.
Any other questions, comments? Roll call, Bonnie.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye, except for under leave of absence, Colleen Marston, I will abstain.
Okay, come. Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Thank you.
Section E, conferences and conventions.
Section E, conferences and conventions. Resolved, the Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes as appropriate the following conferences and conventions as listed in Section E. We have 1 conference, Jesse Smiley through our technology department. This is a State College, Pennsylvania, PSU MAC Administrative 2017 conference as listed in July of 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Question on the motion. is the $1,421 within the budget of the school district. So you let us know if something fell outside of that.
Yes.
Can I comment on that real quick? From what I understand, I don't know if Mrs. Crump, if this is what the other ones do. I'm talking to Jesse on this because his price was so high. He includes his mileage, his meals, hotel, and everything. Do all the other ones include that on there when they fill out the papers, when they submit the papers?
They're supposed to, yes.
They're supposed to, yes. But do they do?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Sometimes it'll be less, like if four people are going to one place and one person can't.
Okay. That's what I was just wondering.
Any other questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Section F, administrative report. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. Resolved under administrative resolutions that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes as appropriate following. Items 1 through 11 is listed in Section F, combined study session and regular school board meeting. Item number 1, we've had on 30-day public review the 700 policies along with the 800s, and we have the exhibits that were listed for 30-day display. Item number 2, we have student teachers listed for the second semester. Spring, as you can see, once again, Gateway is a destination for a lot of our student teachers that come from the various colleges within the Commonwealth. Also, under item number 3, facility rental agreements, you see the Atlantic Coast softball baseball tournaments. Once again, they have asked to request usage of our fields in for 10 dates, May through July, at the rate listed. And this would be the Gateway Middle School field. We also have a Indian cultural dance requesting to use the Robert A. Reed Performing Arts Center. Item number 4, special education settlement agreements that the board 4 and 5, they've been kept abreast of over the last several months. Item number 6, section B1 list of bills for the month of October. Mr. Schott, if you want to.
Yeah, this is a typical resolution since the scheduling of the December meeting is so early. It's very similar to what we do for the payment of bills for July as well. But again, with this resolution, approve the payment of all applicable district section B1 list of bills by the business manager for the month of December 2016 in accordance with board policy number 616. And as listed in the note, what we will do, we will cut the bills off on December 15th. I will email a list of section B1 out to the board. Have a week to take a look at those. Any questions, direct them to me by all means. And assuming there's no questions, no issues, through December 21st, they'll be mailed on December 22nd before all of our staff leaves for the holiday break. And items number seven and 8 are actually together. Again, due to the early scheduling of the board meeting and the requirement that the SEC requirement for the district to be able to properly file its audited financial statements with the SEC through the MSA prior to December 31st, it necessitates the approval of both these items. First one being the annual management discussion and analysis for the 15-16 fiscal year. This is actually the very first document that is included in the audited financial statements for that. And also item number 8, which is the formal acceptance and release of the district's June 30th, 2016 audited financial statements for 15-16 fiscal year. As stated, the district's auditors, Dale Mkoski, Axelrod, are still in the process of finalizing those statements. Actually, the draft that they're finalizing first, I will need to utilize to finish the MD&A, and again, that will be included in the audited financial statements. So again, this just enables us to be able to meet our requirements. Similar to list of bills, once we have these statements, I will email those to the board to have the opportunity to review. And our expectation is we will most likely have the auditors come in at the January 17th meeting to make their formal presentation of that. And that'll be prior to our required release of the financial statements to PD and the federal oversight agencies, which is prior to March 31st, 2017. Item number nine is the extension, and actually this is related to the resolution we had last month. I just didn't receive the second resolution in time. This is an extension of the current agreement with Direct Energy Business Marketing, doing business as Direct Energy Business for natural gas transportation services through the Western Pennsylvania Natural Gas Consortium. Again, as you recall, last month it was a negative rate. This is also a negative rate as well, being able to blend and extend the pricing out forward. So again, this is just maintaining that negative rate, which is a tremendous rate for the district. And again, in terms of the current natural gas situation that we're seeing in Western Pennsylvania, we're a major beneficiary of that, not only with the transportation, but also on our commodity rates as well. Item number 10, two additional donations received by the district. First one being the amount of $1,500 from Walter A. Bunt Jr. and Nancy R. Bunt. This is for World Language Mobile Learning Lab software for the high school. Second one being the from Stern, which is the McDonald's Mac Grant to Joy Mattis for STEAM supplies at Mossside Middle School in the amount of $490. Item number 11 is the approve the capital reserve fund budget in the projected amount of $3,819,000, the various capital repair improvement projects, the advertisement of applicable requests for proposals for professional capital-related services, and the advertisement of bids for applicable projects to be completed during the 17-18 fiscal year as depicted in the budget in Exhibit D. Note, the above capital repair improvement projects were previously reviewed and discussed during the previously held Buildings and Grounds Committee meetings. The capital repair improvement projects will be paid for from existing funds contained in the district's general fund fund balance, and will be incorporated into the district's general fund budget as an expenditure, specifically a capital projects fund transfer to the capital reserve fund for the 17-18 fiscal year.
Second. Questions, comments?
Two questions. Number 11. It seems like a lot in one motion there. And I guess just a question for Paul. Typically, when we put things out to bid, we receive bids and then we go over the pricing and then we approve that, correct?
Each one is approved individually, correct.
Okay. Now, how does that change if we're going to blindly approve $3.8 million without seeing any bids come in?
Well, this is establishing the budget for those various projects that are listed.
When they're bid and the bids are open per the individual project, the board will then decide whether or not to move forward individually on each one.
But when we typically bid something, do we give them a price point? Or isn't the purpose of a bid for people to compete and give us their lowest possible cost and then...
Well, they will still do that in a bidding situation. For a project that requires a bid for the bidding requirements, that will be advertised, and every contractor who purveys that type of service will have the opportunity to bid. So just the nature of the bid would provide the lowest price to the district, because they're all competing and they know they're competing with folks. So again, they want to come in with their best price. So again, that's where they decide to analyze how much of a markup in regards to what, and again, for whatever project it may happen to be.
Okay. I just don't know why we have that in there. But the other question I had was the capital projects, water consulting, lighting engineer, non-district labor, architectural services, project support staff, the $222,000 in there. I think that's a pretty big expense. I remember last time we had the discussion about ABM and looking at building projects, and it was brought up that it would be cheaper to do everything in-house, and I was just wondering where this $222,000 came from and really how we came up with those costs.
I'm not sure. I'm looking at the additional expense requirements. Is that...
No, it's a district-wide.
District-wide capital project.
Water consultant, $24,000.
The last thing in the itemized.
That's what I'm looking at too.
Where did you get those?
I'm sorry. I just
let you know. I consolidated that PowerPoint into this presentation.
Oh, okay. So what they're looking.
Yeah, that's where. That
all right.
Comes
so.
From.
Have we talked to water consultant? Bob
can probably provide some more detail on this. But first of all. I'm looking at a number that says $181,000.
It includes your, it includes your support staff in there.
Yeah,
for
$49,000.
Which doesn't include.
We have essentially three consultants and one set of project support staff. The consultant is water, lighting, and architectural services, and we estimated those at $24,000, $24,000, and $49,000. The project support staff, since we'll be doing, we expect, the overwhelming majority of this work over the summer, it's going to require a good deal of Bob's time in providing oversight. So he requested that we add an additional 4 hours a day of clerical support service for his department, but only for the duration of the projects. That will enable him to get out and provide the supervision. We'd be expecting to do lighting and plumbing and HVAC work and roof work simultaneously. So we estimated that at, help me.
$41,000.
What was the per hour rate?
Well, it was with overhead at $20.
So what was the hourly rate there, wasn't it?
Well, the total cost.
Yeah.
You know, with all the overhead at 20, so that's
okay. So it's probably $13, $14 an hour. Is that right, Trish?
I apologize. I haven't seen what it is we've proposed. Are we talking about?
It's a secretarial position and an entry position. It would be $10, $11, $12 an hour.
Not if it's a union position.
It'd be non-union.
$10. Substitutes $10 if it's okay. For a specific project. When we made the motion, we could tie a certain dollar amount to
yeah,
it
I
for
think
that
that's
position
the way
based
we approach
on the
this,
job description.
And then we build in the overhead, FICA, UC, workers' comp, and any other benefits that go with that. When the projects have been substantially completed or they drop off, then Bob will come back to us and talk to us about
the elimination
of that position. The other thing is that these consultants will be bid out, so they may be over or under those numbers, but they're going to be needed for speccing out the information required to put them out for bid. Am I correct about that?
Yes.
Okay.
As far as the water consultant, the lighting consultant, mm-hmm. engineer, there is so much new technology out there and things that are on the market that we don't have the expertise to pinpoint all of this. We did pick these numbers, you know, through discussions, talked it over, and we would, you know, we have to search these people out. We have not discussed this with people, but, you know, looking at some costs, this is what we thought that it was.
So these numbers are very rough.
Yeah.
You know,
so we have no guarantee then that we will not stay under budget with these numbers because they're basically widely estimated.
Well, they are rough estimates, okay, but each position would be brought to the board for board approval. So you'll have these numbers in front of you.
And if we go over budget, we just stop the project?
I think probably the better way to look at it is, so I took a look at this number, and this number really is a very small percentage of the overall budget, 0.0255% of the overall budget. We expect to be pretty much in the realm of accurate on these. But let's just say, for example, that a lighting engineer comes in at $34,000. No, I wouldn't think we'd recommend stopping the budget. I think Bob would then explain why there would be that variance. What I expect to see happen, and I discussed this at length with Bob and with the Buildings and Grounds Committee, is that as we walk, the reason for adopting the budget is that as we walk through each project, as people bid on it, we're going to have a budgeted number that we're aware of, that they will not be aware of. And then we'll be able to compare the bid against the budgeted number. The budgeted numbers weren't all just pulled out of the air. There was a lot of research done by Bob and some research done by myself. For example, we went out into the market to determine what HVAC systems would likely cost by, and an example, and I think I shared this with you, I actually went up on the roof at Ramsey. I I took all of the operating, the numbers off of it and went out into the commercial market to see what those replacement units would cost.
So those are materials only, not labor and installation and profit?
No, it would be a total bid including installation, okay? And whatever they're going to mark it up. So as we walk through, let me give you another example. We estimated a per square foot rate for roof replacements. We know they're build up roofs. We did that a year or two ago. We're putting out a larger bid, so we expect those numbers to be equal or perhaps a dime per square foot less. And we constructed our budgets around those particular figures. You can get a lot of this information off the internet, which is what he did and what I did, when you go out to determine these estimates. So they're less rough, if you will. But as we go through this, let's just say we miss something by $500,000. That's not going to happen, but let's just say we did. Then I think the board should be saying, well, okay, if that's what we have to spend on this particular item, will that put us over budget? And let's assume that everything else was on mark, then yeah, we'd be over budget and we'd have to decide then what we want to do. So that's not going to happen, but it could happen in terms of $10,000 or $15,000, $20,000.
So I have a few questions. I guess the first would be for you, Bob. When most schools undertake a $4 million renovation project, is that usually handled in-house? Do they usually have a general contractor? How's that?
Well, if it was one project, I would say they would go outside and have an architectural firm and to put it all together. We're talking about a number of different smaller projects that make it up. So there is many things here that
involve two or three buildings too.
But yeah. This is going to be, I guess, for the public's information too. This isn't a one and done. Like, there's going to be multiple projects.
There's multiple projects.
So we can expect this to be the next 3 or 4 years.
That goes on throughout multiple buildings.
Okay. So with that being said, would you recommend doing it this way?
I would. We have to move forward.
I completely agree.
We need to do that. There are the items that we selected, for the most part. I mark them what we do in-house, what we're going to need some consultant help with, and then we bid out. Electrical, which is a large portion of this, most of it is going to be in-house. But we do have extra labor built in here, and that's the $84,000 you see, because there's such a large number of fixtures, you know.
Plus, is it not the Gateway High School? Like when I'm looking at, I just happened to have that page. Their lighting upgrades are $225,000. Does that not include something other than just parts?
No, I mean there's an awful
parts.
Lot of lights, and it's
so you're saying
the two parts.
So you're telling me every number above the one that says district-wide capital projects is parts.
No, because some of these numbers that you're looking at are bid out to be installed, like a roof project. Obviously, we're not going to put the roof on. The HVAC systems, those are bid out jobs that would be, you know, material and labor.
Yes.
I agree. Right. I guess my question, where I'm getting lost here is, and when we had looked at this, when we originally put out the bid, we looked at companies to give us bids. And I think we had 7 companies that came in and said, hey, here's what we would do. We had some board members say, well, we can do this for less money doing it in-house. And now I'm looking at $222,000 of added expenditures that were not in the other proposals. And I'm wondering, is this how, I know when you build a building, right, you personally would not go out and say, okay, I need a plumber. Let's get a bid for a plumber. Okay, we need some steel to build this thing, so let's go get a bid for it. And it looks like we're piecemealing this all together. And I know we've had some board members, and I completely disagree with them, that have been highly critical of employees of the district and about certain things in buildings and grounds related. So I'm asking if we're saying, okay, now you are going to play general contractor, and you're going to work all this together. I mean, you're a pretty busy guy without all these projects.
I am.
So does 4 hours of secretarial help fix that, I guess?
I
don't understand. I feel as though if we're doing all these projects and it's going to be over 3 or 4 years, we should hire a company that does this and allow them to do this.
This is all trying to be done before next year.
Yeah, this is not over a 3 or 4 year period.
I agree, but next year we're going to project.
I have every expectation the majority of this work will be completed before the beginning of school next year.
You're right in that, but there's actually more work beyond this that needs to be done too, such as
give me some
a roof at Evergreen.
There's a lot of things beyond what you yes. see here that will need to be done in the
like
future.
The next year.
Yes.
But you, I'm sorry, again, I didn't have this. Thanks.
Yeah, phase two.
Right.
Yeah.
Will be next year. This we'll be doing the same thing.
I was asked to focus on what we could do next summer.
I understand. But I'm just saying. So I look at this and I see this project support staff $41,000 as that's what we're paying. What we would have paid somebody to be a general contractor. That's what we're paying somebody. So that Bob can be the general contractor.
You probably pay somebody kinda. A lot more than $41,000 to be a general.
Well, I just don't think the secretary replaces you, though.
No,
they
obviously.
Don't, but I spend many hours doing secretarial work that, you know,
warranties, plans.
From being out in the field.
These are, you know, we've had a lengthy discussion. I appreciate the, you know, the concerns being raised when this was presented to the Buildings and Grounds Committee. He's going to function as the general contractor with the support of the three yes. consultant services and some secretarial. And as he said, you know, had we gone with the other $11 million cost and you'd have put in just their 5% overhead, just their dollars, their profit margin, that's $550,000. We're talking about $92,000. We're going to get this work done and we're going to bring it in well under the previous estimate of cost, well under that.
But that other stuff was more, but anyway.
But wait a minute, let me, I want to go on just
a
step.
You don't have the right number, because yeah. $222,000 of $3.8 million is more than
no, phase one. I was just taking, I was just taking the support services number, okay? That's all I was taking off of my presentation, They just handed me this, okay? But here's the point. We made a decision and recommend this to the Buildings and Grounds Committee, which, you know, has approved it and recommends it. We broke this discussion in detail down to things that need to be done now versus things that need to be perhaps discussed further. Let's use the roof at Evergreen, for example. Part of our discussion at that meeting was, do we want to keep Evergreen as a facility or not? So until the board makes those kinds of decisions, doesn't make any sense to replace the roof, because the roof still has 4 or 5 years of useful life, or some useful life in it.
Evergreen is actually included.
Oh, it is. Which one? Okay, I'm sorry. Which one am I talking about?
University.
All right, University Park. Okay. We didn't plan anything for the junior high across the road, because this board hasn't made a decision as to what it wants to do with the junior high across the board. So it wouldn't be prudent to spend money until the board decides you want to tear it down, you want to sell the property. What do you want to do?
I'm for this, actually.
Okay.
That's what I just want to state that first of all. Because
well, I mean,
I want to get the stuff done,
and we will get it done. And
you know, you're talking about keep Evergreen, not keep Evergreen. I'm looking at this, and we're spending $570,000 on Evergreen. So I'm sure hope we're keeping it. You know, that's a big chunk of cash right there, like. If we plan on getting rid of it, I think we should keep our $570,000.
Okay, I see what you're referencing. I think the recommendation is at this point in time, Evergreen's going to be kept. The four elementaries are going to be kept. The two buildings that are on the blocks are the junior high and the Mossside Middle, and those are decisions that require a good deal more discussion.
Overall, I think everyone knows we need to move forward with capital improvement projects. I guess,
right.
Is this what you recommend to be the best solution, or is this what we're left with now?
What's that mean? What does that mean? I don't know what that means.
Well,
under what circumstances?
At this point, our other option was voted down. This was brought to me that, you know, we need to move forward. This is our other option.
This is plan B to get work
done. Yes, and I know we can't do everything in 1 year, a lot of these, the large items that you see here, the two roofs, the HVAC system, the switchgear, these are going out to public bid for companies to come in and do it. They're beyond the manpower we even have in the district.
Absolutely.
We are tackling primarily the lighting exchanges, changing out the fixtures at these areas. And there's still a lot of those, starting with the exterior, and then trying to hire a lighting consultant or engineer to help decide the best way to attack the interior.
Is that person for $24,000, just curious, are they going to be able to tell you this light, you use these lights, you're going to save whatever.
X amount of dollars.
Or you use this one, are they going to have the expertise to do all that?
That's the person that we have to search out.
One of the items that Bob and I that sat down along with Steve
is ensuring that when we complete these projects, we're not installing outdated materials that perhaps are on shelves. We want to make sure that we have the state of the art up to date.
What?
If it's LED lighting, that's efficient.
Yeah. Cost, so I guess, but the only problem is, though, when you do that, see, here's the problem I see with it. When you have a partner that is going to be around and wants to help you and wants to always be there, you know, because they're being held responsible for it because they're maybe guaranteeing savings or whatever, they have a different motive than the $24,000 consultant that wants to sell you who knows what they want to sell. They want to sell you what they got in the back of their warehouse, maybe.
Neil,
I don't know what they want to sell.
Neil, I don't know if you're relitigating the ABM issue or not.
I never brought that up.
It certainly sounds like you are. But let me address the point perhaps more specifically. When we go forward with the HVAC systems, when we go forward with the purchase of the roofs and have the roofs installed, we will buy, as part of the deal, extended warranties so that the equipment will be protected actually the same way that it would have been protected under the prior bid. The difference here is that we're going to be able to identify exactly the equipment that we want to make certain that it's state-of-the-art equipment. When I talk with Brown, with Bob Brown, you know, our conclusion, and I made this clear to the Building and Grounds Committee, was that this is all, this is not Band-Aids on things. These are significant upgrades to the facilities that we're talking about. So we will have extended warranties on these products. We will be dealing with local firms who will service these on an ongoing basis. I don't expect we'll have any major difficulties whatsoever going forward. So those who sell us the roofs, the HVAC systems, will be obligated under those extended warranties to service them if there's a problem with them.
So I guess last thing and then I'm done. I think everyone agrees these things need to be done. I think really the only question at hand tonight is how do we go about doing them? Obviously, what Bob Brown had recommended was shot down by the board, so now we're at option B. Do you think this is a viable option? I guess would be a question to you. And is there a chance that we could have a bunch of architect fees like we did for previous projects that we're just going to spend money on and waste taxpayer dollars?
We discussed that in length on the front side. To bring in our existing architect for the initial projects, not guaranteeing anything beyond these first projects, which is really the two roofs, the HVAC, and the switchgear, and limited to that with a solid number from them up front on what their cost to us is going to be. They've already written the specs for these roof systems. They've done that work. We've already paid for it. Mr. Short and I, you know, we need to have a solid number up front. No phantom costs, no extra bills. Here's the cost. Here's the job. What's the cost?
Well, the other question I have then is the architect of record, that expired in June. So do we have to rebid?
It's a contract.
Okay, so we're
going to
go back to
people that are in the last projects that they did 3 of them with us throughout those the total of those three projects, we had one change order. It was a credit. With those roof systems, it was a good deal for us on that. I didn't see any reason to interview five new, architectural firms and go through that whole process and delay it.
I just want to make sure they're not adding on a field presentation
but
or anything else.
If we want to do that for down the road with new architects, that's up to you folks.
We discussed that at the building and grounds meeting. Once we complete this first phase and perhaps some additional phases within those elementary buildings, once we get down to the decision with Mossside Middle School and Gateway Middle School, at the request of the board, then we would go out, interview architects, determine if we want to maintain the existing architect or choose another one.
All right. And then last question is for Paul, and then I promise I'm done.
That's my turn.
The wording here, the board could at any point in time change their mind and reallocate that $3.8 million, correct?
We are not allocating the money. We are not moving the money until we approve a project.
Correct.
The architect says, $60,000.
Yeah.
We say, okay, you're moving $60,000.
Correct.
Well, so my question is, why do we have that 3.8 in there? It's not like we're putting into, so if we put into the capital improvements, the board would be tied. We can only use that money for capital improvement.
It's not being moved. It's just a related number in relation to the budget. The expectation, as indicated, is that it will be incorporated into the 17-18 budget because, again, we're using fund balance. So, for instance, right now, we couldn't move $3.8 million if we wanted to from the general fund. It was never a budgeted expenditure. We would be exceeding the budget. But for next year, 17-18, we're anticipating this, anticipating the movement of funds. That's why it would be budgeted in there. But even it being a lot, you'll see this line item in next year's budget. We're not going to move the whole dollar amount for that. We're only going to move what is necessary when it's necessary to pay for the projects that are being approved.
I just want everybody to hear that.
Yeah, and that's
important. I'm not saying we're not doing this, but let's say for whatever reason we're not going to do the water conservation, and it's $60,000 in one building and $120,000 in another,
right.
And blah, 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 blah.
Right.
It's like $400,000.
Right.
I'm just making the number up.
Yeah.
We just say, you know what, that's just way too much. We can't do it.
That's right.
So then we will not even allocate that money at all.
I agree. I just don't understand why there's enough. We've never done this for any other bid. Where we
no,
just
that's
throw
right.
Well, here's the reason that we're doing this, okay? We're bringing to the board a budget that anticipates costs by line item and by school, okay? So that the board understands what are we anticipating to do and where are we anticipating to do it, all right? So we're saying where, and we're saying what, and we're saying this is the anticipated dollar cost. Now, as the projects come before the board for approval, as each one comes before the board and approval, you're now going to have, if you will, a baseline or a barometer against which you can judge whether or not that roof bid is $100,000 over the estimated cost or not. And that's what I think we would want. So we expect it to be about $3.8 million given this scope, and we expect that it will accomplish these things as we go forward. But each and every number will be brought before
right.
this board.
And I believe, I only have one issue with it, because I guess I conceptually can't figure it out. We can't use the fund balance to pay for it, but we want to pay for it.
No, we can't use the fund balance.
Well, no. We can't use it until next... Until next budget session.
So we
can't really start doing it anything until we can do the budget?
These projects wouldn't begin until June of next year.
Well, right. The budget's in July, but
we won't be getting invoiced until July.
Yeah.
For these projects.
No, well, that's not quite true because some of the consultants and stuff are like it up front actually. So I'm not sure how we're going to pay for it before we actually are allowed to move money. So that's my one concern about it. I'm not, you can tell me. Just tell me, how are we going to pay before we can move money? Do we have a means of paying anything before July?
for that. If we absolutely had to, we would. Here's what we would have to do. Let's just say we had to make a payment to somebody in May for whatever reason it may happen to be. What we're able to do, we're able to do this for anything, whether it's a project like this or anything else. You can analyze existing budgeted accounts, and if there, say, there's one or multiple accounts that are underspent, you could utilize those funds immediately because it was still original amount that was appropriated. So there's options available
to
us.
There is some, but not
to a 3.8 million magnitude.
Like I said at the beginning, I'm actually for this. I'm going to get all this stuff done. But I want to make sure we're going about it the right way and everything's being done right. So that being said, we're not going to get all these done before next school year with what you just said. Because we can't spend the money. So
No, that's not right. It'll be in the next operating budget.
17, 18.
95, 98% of the invoices will come due and present.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. I don't think that that's true. I think we want to start doing some things
sooner. Well, like he said,
we need time to do the bid process. We can't start a lot of this stuff, most of it, before school's out.
Okay, so let's start. So now let's go back now. If we're not starting this till school's out, we're going to be done before school starts. Why do we need $41,000 for some secretary for 2 months of 4 hours a day?
You know what?
What we're trying to do
here is to provide the resources necessary to undertake and accomplish the renovation work that that we've outlined here.
But you got
to now wait a minute, okay? And we're going to do it in the proper way. There's nothing improper about this. We're not talking about bringing a clerical person on next week or the week after. When it's required, then we'll do it. Now, as Paul said, if we end up, for whatever reason, spending $100,000 or $150,000, you pay for it out of current operating budgets, we'll be able to do that. And am I correct? Would that then be reimbursed by the capital budget going forward?
No.
Then we'll just spend less of the capital budget going forward. That's the way we'll be able to handle it. And it won't be a challenge to us either. It won't be a challenge financially, and it won't be a challenge in terms of it'll be a challenge in terms of getting the work done, but we'll be able to get it done. We'll bring it in on budget. This board will approve each and every project, each and every expenditure, and you'll be able to determine as we walk through this whether or not we're under budget, on budget, or over budget.
I agree with you, except for I don't know about the time frame. I think the time frame
Steve just said it's going to be on budget. So.
If it's that amount and it's done before next school year, everybody wants to do it. But
well, listen, could it bleed into the first term? Sure, it could. But you have to understand, some of this work can be done on weekends. It can be done in evenings.
When you're saying that means you're going to be starting it sooner, and therefore you need to
I'm saying that some of this work, for example, if you're concerned about the time frame, okay, and let's just say it bleeds over into the coming semester, we would not have spent the amount of money that we would have approved. And let's just say the lighting electrician people, they'll be able to work in the evenings to complete the contract. Might take them into 3, 4, 5 weeks or 6 weeks of the next year, but it would not interrupt services, would not interrupt the educational process at all.
All right, so we're going to start,
starting projects until they're approved.
When do we plan on that? Do you have them?
It takes a minimum of, 10 weeks we decide for a roof, just to get it through all the proper, the bid process.
10 weeks.
January, February, March.
10 weeks, just that it takes us to get through that. That's after the architect has told us, go ahead and put it together. So what we want to do in that particular instance, which other school buildings are doing the same thing right now, I had a phone call from a contact that North Allegheny is going to be working and having one out in January for the same product. You need to get it out there and on their list. We don't need to move forward once we approve it. It's a certain date that we select. We could, you know, but we have to do our legwork on the front side, and that's going to take.
I'm all for that.
We got 60, 70, 80, 90 days or more of preliminary work in developing the schedules and putting the bids out and speccing out the bids and getting the bids back in and reviewing the bids, reviewing them against the budget, and then bringing them before the board for board approval. But once that's done, it doesn't mean we start that day. What it means is we've locked in that contractor to do that work, say starting, what's the first day they're off? June 1st or whatever, wherever the kids are at. Okay, so they start June 1st. And Scott and I and Jim Capel did this 3 or 4 years ago with actually about the same amount of money. I think it was about $3 million or so. And we lined up multiple contractors the same way to begin the day school let out. And so what they had done is they went out and they stockpiled, actually, the equipment and the materials here. When the kids got out of school, the very next day they were doing that. It was the football field,
tennis courts,
the parking lots, the painting, the tile removal, the carpeting. It was all scheduled, and it was all done for the start of school.
I'm good.
Okay. I was an ardent, a strong voice against the ABM. You guys asked me to come back with an alternative proposal. I've done that. I've worked it out with Bob and administration and put it before the Buildings and Grounds Committee. And while there are no guarantees in life, but this will be done. The vast majority of it will be done. It will be on budget, and it will be done by the beginning of school. Let me point one other thing out that has not been raised here. We have not tried to anticipate any offsetting cost savings. No tax credits, no rebates, no electrical savings or anything of that sort. I honestly don't think that would be worth our while to do. It would be a little bit of a guessing game. But there's a substantial amount of money to be saved through this initiative. Okay, so, and we'll be getting that. I'm just not going to relitigate the ABM issue.
Well, I'm going to relitigate it just for a minute. I was willing to let it go, Steve, until I looked at this $222,000 of water consultants, lighting engineers, electricians, labor, architectural services, and project support staff.
Which one are you under?
That's the $222,000 in fees. And one of the big reasons you were against ABM was because you said their fee. You were really adamant about their fees. ABM's fees range between 5 and 10%, which puts us on the same amount of project at 195%, which is less than your fees, and a max of 380. So what we're giving up here to self-manage our project is we're taking our facilities manager, we're making him a project manager, hiring a clerical support staff because he won't be able to handle his workload at an estimate of $41,000. We're giving up a project manager from a company like ABM, doesn't have to be ABM, but like ABM, who guarantees us a minimum of 15 years experience managing large projects like schools and municipalities like we're doing. We're also giving up the procurement leverage that a company like ABM has because they've negotiated purchasing agreements with water consultants and lighting engineers, who Mr. Brown says, I pretty much have to go find them when ABM already has them. So we're giving that up. And with that procurement leverage also comes a price plan that they have already negotiated, because obviously they buy in bulk and they do large projects. So they have a price point that is probably going to come in less than us piecemealing a project together. Also, when you piecemeal projects together like we've decided to do ourselves, you have something called markup stacking, which occurs when you have multiple subcontractors. So we're going to have subcontractor here, 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 and here, and they're all going to mark up their fees. And in the end, we're going to pay a bigger price than if we would have gone with a company like ABM. We wouldn't have the stacked markup. We would have a set markup. So my prediction is that we will actually not save money. It will cost us more money. We will have less experience. We will have no guaranteed savings either, and we will not have a partner to work with us. So we're basically taking our facilities manager and telling him that he has to manage this project. And these numbers that you estimated, you basically said you pulled from the internet and you pulled from guesses. We haven't talked to water consultants yet. We haven't talked to lighting engineers yet. We haven't even talked to the architect yet. So if you can stay on budget, I'll buy you dinner. Okay?
Would that be a dinner at my the restaurant of my choice?
Sure.
I hope that's being recorded, because I'm a guy who tends to stay on budget. So break open the piggy bank
and
keep it on
the
side.
Two, and if you're wrong, if I'm right, phase two will be hired by a partner and facilitated phase two by a company like ABM.
No.
Yes.
I just listen, I'm not going to go back and forth. I just respectfully disagree with about most of what you said.
I'm glad Steve and I don't see eye to eye on this.
Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, unfortunately, I forgot my laptop this morning to review the new policy 713, 709.1, and 709. Can I just have a brief description to jog my memory from a month ago? It's not attached.
Which one?
713, 709.1, and 709. Just a brief.
The reappeal of the school police.
But there was nothing else. Okay.
And electronic surveillance as well. That I believe Mr. Brown was your mic up talking about how the additional uses of cameras, but we also included the use of audio for our school buses.
Okay, right. Okay.
Yeah. So, mm-hmm.
And then the cell phone.
The cell phones, through a discussion here with the administrators, because of the use of the cell phones and the plans and the prices that have increased, we've taken a number of our Act 93 employees who were receiving $30 a month and raised that up to $100 a month.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments?
I make a comment on the policy issue. That's been an issue, Chad, that you've undertaken over the last year, and it's pretty boring and dull. Project. It's not as exciting as renovations. Right. Well, no. But I just want to say I appreciate that. That's, you know, that's sitting in a room with other, with I know you brought in administration and teachers, and you grind through all of these policies.
Having sat through it for the last 3 years, it is an opportunity for building principals, other personnel to become familiar with our actual policies, see how they are applied. And, I have to commend Chad.
Yeah, I think it's a good job. Well done. Job well done.
Yeah. Because
yeah.
He did a fine job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any other questions or comments? Barney, roll call.
Mr. Nola.
Okay. I'm an aye on everything except. Four. No. Five. No. And that's it.
Okay, Mr. O'Donnell.
Wait one second, just back up for a minute. We're approving. The motion was for sections, help me here.
F, just F.
Section F. Okay, and Neil?
Four and five, he voted no.
Settlement agreement and what else?
The
two settlement agreements. Aye.
Mr.
For all.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye. Number 11, and not because I don't believe projects need done, just because it's not what our supervisor recommends.
That's now our number 11. Okay. Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye to all but Section 1, Policy 709.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye. Aye to all.
Except 11, capital reserve fund budget, capital repair improvement projects, no.
And Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye, except, no, that's a good, aye to them all.
Motion carries.
What was the vote? I just, what was the count?
Four.
We had two noes on numbers 4 and 5. We had one no on, two noes on number 11, and one no on policy 709.
Okay.
It's like 7 to 2.
Okay.
Section G, resolutions presented by board members.
All righty. I have three this evening. All right. I'll do 1 and 2 together, and we can vote on number 3 separately. So the first one is district donations. Day Automotive, through their foundation, is donating $5,446.30 for the Gateway police officers to purchase body armor, bulletproof vests. And number 2, which in line goes with that, approves the purchase of the body armor for the school district police through Whitmer Public Safety Group in the amount of $5,446.30, as depicted in Exhibit C. So I'd like to vote on both of those together. Once we get a motion and a second, I can talk about that a little bit.
Second.
All right. So with that being said, Day Automotive was contacted through Pete Flaherty, who has a student in the district, has connection obviously with the automotive group, and he has a good working relationship with Tim Skoog, who's one of the school police officers. So they started talking and got the ball rolling here. Debbie had reached out to me and asked, you know, if this was something that the district wanted help with. The police, you know, through Brian Key, through Tim Skoog, definitely wanted this, and obviously it reduces the cost that we have to use of taxpayer dollars. So they did present us with the check, so this is just simply approving the check and then approving the purchase of that. So if anyone has any questions, I'm more than willing to answer.
Is it possible to hold off on a purchase of these body armors until they have been approved? Because once you order these, they are fit to size of the individual, and if for some reason they are not approved and you are ordering 10 body bulletproof vests for nothing.
Well,
I'm just asking.
Yeah, I think regardless that it's a good piece of protective equipment, regardless of whether or not they are able themselves to carry a firearm. So
it
I would
just
think
protects them, though.
We would.
Right.
If somebody walks into school tomorrow with a gun, they
okay.
Have
my
armor.
Question is, we had 3 security guards here for how many years? They did not have bulletproof vests.
So is that the reason you do not
I'm
want
not
to
saying that, but I'm
accept
saying
a donation?
Is, no, I'm not saying that.
Okay.
I'm saying that I don't feel that the reason that we are getting these body armors is because they're looking forward to being approved as officers, because we're looking at the recipients as being Gateway police officers. We do not have Gateway police officers as of yet. So I know it's a small word, but we do not have a police force yet here at Gateway.
But I say to that statement,
they're here.
They're here.
Somebody's willing to pay to protect them.
Right.
Who is, and they are in turn protecting our students, our staff, and everybody. They're here. You turn down money, you don't get money next time. Like, I think you should take the money for what it was intended, do what it is. They're actually in the building here, performing a job here, being paid for. So I don't know how you could.
And they
okay,
feel,
so
no, and
so
they,
what, let's say that this is not approved. Fine, they're still going to be here. Like, why? What are we going to do? Fire them? I don't think that that's the path that we're going to take. So
you're
they're going to be here.
You're actually suggesting that we turn down
I didn't
money.
Say turn it down. I'm saying not to order them until to see if they are approved.
Okay, so you're saying let's not protect our vulnerable officers who are unarmed longer than necessary when we have the means to tomorrow order them bulletproof vests to protect them, which they have asked for. That you're dead wrong on that.
Okay, let me ask
sorry.
Questions. Do they have bulletproof vests of their own?
So there are 10 that are being purchased. Several do have some that are coming up within expiration. So Debbie had talked with them, and they said, look, we have some that are good for quite a while. We would only need 10.
How many, can I ask how many cards we have right now?
We had a question for Trish. 13. I believe we had 13 last year.
13.
That's counting the three supervisors. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm not saying not to turn it down. My only thoughts were to hold off until they were approved.
Very good. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
Do you want to vote on one and two?
Yes.
Together, right, Chad?
Yes.
We have a roll call, please.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Very good. Number three, the purchase of Narcan kits. So the naloxone policy has just been adopted and accepted under Section F. So this would actually be the purchase of the Narcan. So another huge thanks to Forbes Hospital. Myself and Bill Short sat down with the president over there, a few physicians, a few from the emergency department, our own school physician, our school nurse who's in the buildings, and discussed ways of actually implementing Narcan. So the governor is willing to give us one dosage of Narcan for free, which expires within a year, and then you have to purchase it at $400 a dose. So we didn't think that was a good option. So what I did was I reached out to Forbes. We all got together in a room and saw, okay, this is being provided on the ambulance. It's a very inexpensive cost. I'm familiar by using it. And Forbes is actually willing to sell it to us at their cost, as opposed to us going to CVS and purchasing it at a much higher cost. So this is for eight Narcan kits that will be throughout the district. If anyone has questions on storage, I would rather answer privately, just simply because we don't want everyone to know where this is. It does, obviously, it is an expensive product. So in the implementation, administrators, all school nurses, and the police officers will be trained on utilization. From that point forward, what we will do is we'll be reaching out to the GEA, and anyone, any teachers that are interested in receiving the training are welcome to receive the training, but they're not being mandated to.
So moved.
Second.
Questions, comments?
I have a comment. You know, if anybody thinks that they cannot influence political bodies like this one, then they need to look and talk to Nancy Lapsevich, because she's the person that brought this issue up and has continued to raise it in front of the school board and raise it appropriately. And then the action that was required, you know, is being taken by the school board. So, you know, hats off to community involvement and for, you know,
right,
taking a stand on an important issue.
Yeah, I'd like to thank Nancy and Chad, actually. Chad puts a lot of time and energy, yep, into all these things.
Yeah, but Chad gets paid. Don't you, Chad?
Big picture.
I thought we didn't get paid for this, Joe.
Steve does.
I'm the one who gets.
Any other questions or comments? Bonnie, can we have a roll call, please?
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning. Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
I double aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Any other resolutions by board members? Seeing none.
Comment.
It's resolution time. I'm sorry.
I just wanted to comment on it. That was nice that Chad put those in the resolution thing. I think that that's a good, appropriate use of board resolution space.
Oh, yes, very well done, Chad.
Thank you.
That was the one other thing I wanted to
do. Hats off, Chad. Thank you. Administrative reports. Mr. Trump.
Nothing at this time.
Nothing further, thank you.
Nothing at this time.
Wow, short.
Two items. I would like to invite the public. We're going to send invitations along to all the PTOs, FTOs, parent organizations within the district on December 14th at 6:30 p.m. in the high school LGI, which was outfitted with new lighting, I might add, done internally. When you walk in, you feel like you're in an operating room. And Bob, your people did a nice job with that, as well as Micah, who installed a new projector not too long ago.
But we will have a review of our district report card. Finalization of all the SPP scores.
Which we're switching from.
Which eventually will be switched from with the new Every Student Succeeds Act. However, the SPP is still in effect, and we would like to provide the public, myself, the administrative team, with an overview of our student achievement and growth from the 15-16 school year. So just an invitation to everyone out there who would like to be just impressed by the efforts of our teachers, our students, our parents, the community, to see where we are at, where we have been, and where we are going, because it's been a tremendous, tremendous increase in our test scores. It's highlighted by our new website, and I think we need to celebrate that and get the message out. Also, once again, Nancy, we had conversations, Lapsovich, going back several years. And it's finally nice to have a culmination of a lot of committee work, George included, but also colleague Chad here, and also our nurses who have put in a lot of time, and the administrators, to finally bring this to fruition. Because to think we are immune to this epidemic of opioid overdose, it's hitting every community. Every county in Pennsylvania and throughout the country. So we have taken those steps, along with many other districts, not only in Allegheny County, but Westmoreland County, and truly a lot of work to get this done. And thank you, Chad.
Thank you.
That's it.
Board reports. Mr. O'Donnell.
Congratulations to Scott and to Valerie for being elected president and vice president. For people who are watching, that means a lot of work for them, more work for them than it does on the rest of the board members. The second thing I want to note is that the board will be receiving the final report from the GAP committee very soon, probably within a week or so or less. All that needs to be done is a final read by myself, and that'll be done again quickly. And then, just to sort of alert the board, the committee would like, the GAP committee would like, a special board meeting to be held at a time convenient to the board. And so I think probably, Mr. Williams, the best thing is to ask Bonnie to send a note out, schedule a special board meeting. The committee wants an hour or so, the board's time, to explain what was done and what the recommendations are, and if there are any questions, to answer them. And I promised them I would ask the board for a special meeting on that matter. And along those lines, Mary Beth and Scott and Stephanie were the four board, and myself were the four board members on that committee. And it's been, they've had to put a lot of time in, and I appreciate that time. I really do. They're two-hour meetings, held regularly. The full report is, they've seen it. I think, impressive work. And I think it once again shows the commitment of this board to ensuring that all students' academic needs are addressed to the best of our ability. And I'm proud of a board that stands behind things like that. So that's it, Mr. Williams.
Thank you. Byrne?
Going off of what Steve said in our discussion at our last meeting when we talked about the activity bus for tutoring, Mr. Short has already looked into that, and we're getting ready to offer that beginning, yes, the next semester, so that's great. A bit of housekeeping. I noticed that the Tri-Cog Land Bank is having its first meeting on Thursday. We have a representative from Gateway for that, right?
Correct.
Okay, right. Excellent. It's Chad.
Did we vote? Yeah. That was appointed, yes.
Whenever we originally voted on the family.
Okay, just making sure.
Yes, indeed.
And I'd like to wish everyone a happy holidays. Thank you.
George?
Yeah. I just want to thank Chad and Mr. Nola on their, as being president and vice president this past year. We had some rough water, especially the ones that just started on this board. But we came through it, and I appreciate your backing on not everything, but the majority of the stuff. And this board doesn't hold any grudges of any kind. And I want to welcome Scotty as the president, which I feel in my heart that he was overdue the last 15 years. And Valerie, that she's like me. She doesn't let no stone unturned. And that's why she got my vote as vice president. Thank you.
Thanks, George. Val?
Yes, I just wanted to thank the board for voting me in as vice president. I hope to do the best. I still have things to learn, which hopefully I am learning as we go. But I promise to do everything that I can to the best to my ability. Winter sports has started. Looks that we are going to have a good girls and boys basketball team. It's indoors, so we don't have to worry about dressing for the outside weather. So schedules are all throughout the district. Get yourself one. To Gateway Middle School, they have started their math tutoring program after school. Thank you, Mr. Telly, for putting that together. And I believe this activity bus will help more students be able to attend it. And Mrs. Lapsevich, thank you for your pushing to get that into the schools. And I just want to wish everyone a happy holiday.
Mary Beth?
Well, it's been a fun year one on the school board. I thank everybody. It's been a pleasure to work with you, and I look forward to year two. Congratulations, Scott and Val. And I would like to just wish everybody a Merry Christmas, a Happy Hanukkah, and a healthy, safe, and happy New Year. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Ritter.
Sure. Chad and Neil, thanks very much for your hard work. Welcome, Val. Scotty, here we go. Quick report. ESSA is doing a statewide tour. That's the Every Student Succeeds Act. They're collecting input. So one of the undersecretaries of education is introducing it to a crowd. I went to that that meeting a couple days ago. What they do is they give you a form with about 10 pages on it. You answer questions. Do you like this? Do you like that? They're collecting input right now. So if the board members would like that, I could send that hyperlink out again. You can download that. You can offer your 2 cents about what you think about the ESSA, the direction that they're about to take Pennsylvania State Schools. Number two, I went to the Regional Hope Summit at Plum High School, where Dr. Michael Lynch, a recent Gateway graduate, a young guy, demonstrated the use of Narcan, and some FBI folks were there. There was a pharmacist, and they spoke about the influx of drugs. It's scary. I was scared sitting there in the audience listening to how cheap these drugs are, how they capture you instantly. So I would recommend that we would invite those folks to come and have a session here at Gateway. I talked to them about that afterward. They would love to be invited to come and put the same presentation on for us again. And so that's all I have. Merry Christmas to all. You know, I like chocolate. That's my favorite. If anyone's thinking about it. But sincerely, it's been a pleasure working with all of you this year, and I'm still honored to be a school board member. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
Here we go.
Mr. Nola.
Thank you, sir. I just have a couple quick things, I hope. First off, get our cameras and turn towards the pictures over there. Look at those pictures. That's phenomenal, isn't it? It amazes me every time I walk in this room and I look at that board, and I go over there and stand and get close to them and look at them. It's amazing the talent that we have in the students, and I just love looking at them. It's just,
you recognize
just
the
awesome.
Swimmers or renderings of the young Neil Nola several years ago.
Sure. I still want that one that was up there. That was the best one ever, actually. All right, I want to say thanks to the board and everybody for, you know, fixing our buildings. I think that that's a very important thing. I think that we, as a board, recognize the responsibility that we have to protect, you know, everybody, the students, the staff, everybody, the teachers, the administrators, everybody. And part of it is the physical structures in which they work in. We need to make sure that they're sound, up to date. And, you know, so I appreciate everybody putting in the effort that they did to do that. Next thing, I'm a firm believer in building everybody up and not breaking them down. So I just want to build everybody up, and hopefully we just have a great year moving forward. That's what I think. We should always be building on getting better and better and better every single day, every single year. I just want to see improvement, improvement, improvement. So that's a goal and a challenge to all of us. I'd like to wish everybody happy holidays, and I know Mr. O'Donnell does. He missed it earlier, so I wanted to get him in on that, so he had one more chance. And I'm glad to hear that the GAP committee is getting back to the board on this 60-day initiative thing that we did. I just want to make sure that we are finally getting our responses to it.
I'd like to correct the record.
It's 90 days. And oh yeah, we're over by a couple.
A few hundred.
But we're coming through.
Except the capital budget.
I am looking forward to it, though, because I think it's an important thing, actually. So I just wanted to rest Steve a little bit.
Mr. Dice, I apologize. Do you want to add anything this evening?
Merry Christmas.
What do you do with that sweater?
Chad?
A few things to go over. First one, the new website has been up and operational. If anyone finds anything, any links not working, please just email a board member or email Michael Brown. I've had a few people email me who I've sent them.
Michael.
Okay. Very good. So we are actively chasing those down, so please let us know about those. The capital repair, I'm glad we are finally moving forward there. It's definitely necessary. It's long overdue. Hopefully it stays on budget there, and hopefully we're not in for any big surprises. So. I mentioned last time Gators Give Back with a Gateway alumni, Brittany Smith, who started a group to provide for students. I believe there's about 20 students who have been provided for thus far, and some more teachers and counselors have reached out, and we're starting to go through that as well. So if you're on Facebook, please reach out or look Gators Give Back. Look them up, add them if you're willing to help support their cause in any way. I'd like to throw out an idea that came to fruition based off of a parent emailing me. So Mark Coulter had emailed me about public relations and said that he thinks we're doing a good job, even though we've removed the public relations position, and that we have had some pretty good press as of lately. But is there any way, is there any contact point for public or teachers or anyone to reach out? So I talked to Michael Brown, and we came up with, it's just public relations, no spaces, publicrelations@gatewayk12.org. So if any teachers, any parents, anyone in the community has anything good that's going on in the district that they want to be highlighted, please send it there. It will go to all the administrators, all the board members, and that way we can include parts of that in our speeches. We can get the press involved on certain issues. So it's just a way to keep everyone in the loop. So please jot that down, publicrelations@gatewayk12.org. And thank you to Mark for recommending that we start something there. I want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas coming up. Happy New Year's as well. Up at the high school, I believe there are several tags left. There is a Christmas tree there with some tags. So please, if anyone hasn't grabbed one yet, go up there and grab one. It just has the sex of either male or female and the age, and you're supposed to purchase a gift. Don't wrap it, but put it in a bag, and then you staple it to it, drop it off at the office. So I believe that's going through the rest of the week, if I'm not.
I think it's the 18th.
Okay, so we have some time. So if you haven't, if you'd like to, please stop up there. It's right in the main lobby there at the high school. The last two things, I just want to say a huge thank you to Day Chevrolet. Debbie was great to work with, and very, very thankful for her generous donation to the school and also to Forbes Hospital. It was very refreshing to be able to reach out to them and have a meeting scheduled so quickly, and for them to be able to work with us and provide us with the Narcan at such a reduced rate. So thank you very much to both of them. And then just to keep everyone in the loop too, we're actually trying to keep that Narcan cost as that being the only expenditure ever. And what we're looking into doing, we kind of thought outside of the box, is possibly circulating. So 6 months, a year before it expires, actually circulating that with the drug that is carried on the ambulance. And then Forbes will give us a new dose. So hopefully we can do that, cut down on costs, but much better than spending $6,000 as we had originally looked at. So huge thank you again to Forbes and Day Chevrolet. Want to congratulate Scotty and Val. I think you both will do a great job. And that is all I have.
Thank you, Chad.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank everybody that voted for me and supported me. Congratulations to Val. Hats off to Chad and Neil. They really got us through a rough year, starting last December till now. And they actually put in a lot of time. Chad puts in a lot of time, as you can see. And with the new school board that came on, there was a lot of things that they didn't get the chance to get an orientation like they properly should have. And they more or less had to learn on the job. And with the help of Chad and Neil and myself and some others here, we hope we did a good enough job to welcome them aboard and get them orientated. And with the new assistant superintendents here, I think we're going to move forward in the right direction very quickly. And I think with the support of everybody on this board, and we do get along, even though we don't get along sometimes, but at the end of the night, we do get along, and that's key. And also wish everybody happy holidays, Merry Christmas, and Happy New Year. And is there anybody from the audience that has signed up to speak? Bonnie?
Nancy Lapsovich just signed up when she came in the door.
Okay. Yes.
She's still here.
And I apologize not asking anybody from the audience beforehand if you would like to speak on agenda items.
As Nancy's making her way up, I forgot to remind the board to thank Nancy for keeping the fire under my butt to actually bring that policy to fruition. So thank you, Nancy, and everyone getting involved.
Well, that's what I want to thank Enzal, my husband, and I want to thank Enzal. I don't usually get teary, but I am. And another thing I think the public should know, if they look around, they see that I'm probably the only maybe significant other that comes to these meetings. I feel like an alternative or an alternate board member. This board has done a fantastic job for the school district and for the community, because you were all there doing it and I lived it too. So I would just like to put it out there to the community that they owe everybody, from Bonnie all the way around to Scott, a thank you. They really need to know that. As far as the Narcan goes, I thank Enzal so much. It means a lot to us. And if anyone ever needs help, talk to, call us, George and I. So we're always available for anybody. But I do want to thank Enzal again for your service.
Nancy, when you say call you for help, if you're a parent,
do windows.
If you're a parent and you're watching something troublesome happen with your kid,
absolutely.
And you try to break through to them and you're having trouble, call Nancy. That's what you're trying
absolutely.
To say, right?
Our home. Right. Our phone, we're always available.
It could save a life.
That's what we're here for. That's what we're here for. Thank you all.
Thanks, Nancy.
Thanks,
Nancy. Anybody else wish to speak? You have your name and address?
Lisa Mears, 567 Sunnyville Drive, Monroeville. We mentioned here earlier, student representative, not here because of Keystone exams. Is that a junior or a senior student? Does anybody tell me what grade that student's in?
Mr. Short, I do not have that information.
Yes, because I'm tired of this. The state has dropped the requirement for juniors and seniors, so as a school district, we should make sure that the students are in class learning instead of being in these remedial sessions and et cetera. And in this additional stress of the students is no longer necessary for the class of 2018, the current class, 2017 and 2018. So, and my hope is with the State Board of Education, eventually all the Keystones will be done away with, because colleges, I work for Pitt, University of Pitt, nobody looks at the Keystone. It's used as a measurement for your school district, there's other measurements, there's other things, the new thing that they're doing, but the Keystone just seems like, in a way, a waste of time. You know, we've been doing this for, what, 4 years now or more? And, you know, even though the state has said, oh, it's no longer a requirement, I still had to come into the office, I still had to review the test, I still had to write the letter to opt my child out of a test that is no longer required. So it seems to be a little bit miscommunication. So maybe we can clarify the communications.
Those are the requirements from PPE, which you have to come in, view the test.
Yes, I'm aware of that requirement. For the class that it is no longer required, why do I still have to come in? It's not required for my student.
From PD, they said in order for a parent guardian to opt out, they must view the test and then provide the reason.
And they didn't change that lovely rule when they said we're no longer going to require it for these two classes. So that would perhaps that perhaps then is a lack of, you know, you know, an oversight on the state's board of education. But you know, I guess. But yeah, that's unfortunate. We didn't have a student here, and I kind of miss seeing some of those. You know, the little achievements of the school district and things like that. So, like I said, if you don't get out there to the website and your kids don't tell you these things, there's no way to know all this stuff that's going on. So, thank you for your all your work you guys did this past year. So, hopefully we'll keep improving the school district. That's what I hope to see. Thank you very much. I'm filling up the paperwork here because I can't read my writing.
Anybody
else wish to address
the board?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
We're adjourned. Aye.